Thank you very much for joining us today for the fourth episode of our ACCANect virtual conference series. Before we go any further, I just want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we're all meeting today, and also to recognise elders past, present and emerging. Today, I'm really glad to introduce to you Mark Coulton, the Member for Parks and the Minister for Regional Health, Regional Communications and Local Government. So thank you very much for joining us today, Minister. And I'm going to hand over to you to make some opening remarks.
Thanks, Teresa. Now, it's great to chat with you all. As you can probably tell by my appearance, I'm actually speaking from my home at Warialda, working at home today before going back on the road. I represent half of New South Wales, one of the largest electorates, seventh largest electorate in Australia. So I'm well aware of the issues around communications in regional areas. But I think what 2020 has shown us is that people can live and work remotely in regional Australia and be connected to the rest of the world. I'm speaking to you now through a SkyMaster satellite connection. I worked mostly through last year for weeks at a time, nearly back-to-back meetings with rural health stakeholders and a whole range of other people from around the country as part of my job as a minister from my home here at Warialda on a SkyMaster connection. And I think it's held up pretty well. I have only had one hiccup, and that was across to live television at the same time as the first thunderstorm in about 5 years came through here, and we lost the connection for a couple of seconds. But so someone who lives and works in regional Australia, and I've lived here all my life, I understand the need for connectivity, and I also understand the challenges that we face. And so over the last 6 or 7 years, the government has had a commitment to communications, and we've funded now just over 1,200 towers under the mobile phone black spot program, and round 5A is open now. It's been extended out, I think it's to the 5th of March. And 5A will be looking at some more innovative models. We are looking at maybe slightly different ways to what we have done with the previous towers under partnership with the larger telcos. They're obviously going to be a part of it, but we are interested to see what other applications come through under that round 5A. Just prior to Christmas, the applications closed for the regional connectivity program, and that was $83 million set aside for that. At the moment, we are assessing the projects that have been put in by application for that, and that's looking for, I guess, more bespoke levels of technology to deal with individual cases in the bush. So it might be an industrial area that's not under the direct connection to the NBN. It might be a health precinct. It might be an aged care facility. It could be an area of high-level activity in agriculture with horticulture or something like that. So we are looking, I'm very excited to see when I get back to Canberra next week, the applications for that was oversubscribed. And so there will be not all of the applications will be successful, but we'll be able to pick, I think, some very innovative programs that we will be looking at that. And so apart from that, and I understand that you have had a previous conversation with Paul Fletcher, and towards the end of last year, we announced with the NBN Co some of the regional tech hubs where NBN are putting high capacity broadband, gigabyte services into regional Australia, but no connection charges and at the same cost to the consumer as CBD pricing. And so that's a big step forward. And with COVID encouraging more and more people to look at regional Australia as a safer place to operate, it is important that we are trying to keep up to step with that higher level of of connectivity. And so it's you know, we have a long way to go. We now are down to about the last 100,000 Australians that don't have mobile coverage at their home. Obviously, we also are looking at you know, major transport routes and areas where there are high usages of mobile coverage. And so we do have a way to go. We are committed into the future. Round six of the mobile phone black spot program, which is about $80 million, will be open for application in the first half of this year. We are looking at round 5A and seeing what projects come through there that look like they might have a degree of innovation that can cover some of the issues that we are dealing with. And the design of round six is still open so that we can design the program that is going to be the most applicable for where we are with the technology at the moment. So recognising that there are issues. One more thing before I sign off on my introduction. One of the frustrations that I have is that quite often the solutions that people are seeking for their telecommunications problems are available, but they just don't know about them. And quite often people aren't all as tech savvy. Some aren't as tech savvy as others. And so we've got the regional connectivity hub, telecommunications hub. The tender was successfully taken up by the National Farmers Federation, and they're now in the process of, and they are up and operating. So people that are looking for a solution to their technology problems, their connectivity problems, will be able to speak to a person that's based in the regions that has a technical understanding, but also an understanding of regional issues, and hopefully work through some of those solutions where they can become better connected without having to wait maybe for a new phone tower to go up or something of that like. So I think that's going to be a very popular facility, following on from the terrific work done by volunteers through various organisations, but particularly through the BIR organisation, Better Internet for Rural and Regional Australia. Following on from that work, I think this the hub will be well used. So, Teresa, I might go to questions now, but it's great to talk to you. And, you know, it's an exciting place to be in technology. Frustrating, obviously, at times, but we do recognise the problems, and we are working very hard to come up with solutions that are practical and will and do the job that they need to do.
Thanks for that, Minister. The first question I thought might be good to ask is a focus on the Regional Telecommunications Review, which is a really important opportunity for people in rural, regional and remote regions to have their voices heard when it comes to phone and internet issues. With the next review just around the corner, what do you think are the most important achievements that the government's response from the last review in 2018 actually are? And what issues do you think should the next review focus on?
Look, I think the last review is forming a lot of the basis of what we're rolling out now. Some of the changes to the programs we've made have, you know, with the Regional Connectivity Program, Round 5A, have come from grassroots suggestions from people on the ground that the committee that held the review spoke to. And so we are legislated to have another review coming up within the next 12 months or so. And so we will be using this, the next review, you know, forming a committee, obviously, to do that. But obviously hoping to put a ruler over some of the new programs that we're putting out now. And so it is a bit of a balancing act that we do wait to see, you know, how some of the these more recent programs, or at least starting to roll out, so that we can the committee can then assess whether they're actually doing their job as was hoped. And so, but I would expect before the end of the year, they will, you know, probably halfway through the year, we'll form the committee, and hopefully by the end of the year, they will have another report. And you know, it's a great, it's so important that we use this mechanism to speak to people on the ground, and so that we can respond directly to the problems that they're facing.
Yeah, and I noticed just on Monday that you made an announcement about the alternative voice trials, and that you're seeking registrations from consumers that are interested in participating in the trial.
Yeah, we certainly are, and you know, a lot of the wireless loops that service some of our more remote parts of Australia are coming to the end of their life. You know, they're not as reliable as they should be, and there's issues around sourcing parts, and obviously some areas that are still on the copper network, where, you know, that's their only form of connection, and it's no secret that, you know, we're starting to get some issues around the reliability of that copper network. And so the alternative voice trials are an opportunity to look at what, you know, what's there in the most latest up-to-date technology. And it's important that if we are going to make changes the way that we deliver services to some of those more remote and harder to fit places, that the people are going to get an improved service and not one as what they've got, or an inferior one. And so these trials are really important for the government to engage with telcos, and once again, people on the ground, to trial some of these alternatives to see what works and what maybe doesn't.
And I think people can go onto the department's website now to register their interest in that trial. I also wanted to ask you, seeing as it's really a year now since the large parts of the nation were impacted by the terrible bushfire season, you know, I know that the Coalition has committed $37 million towards a program called Strengthening Telecommunications Against Natural Disasters. And I wanted to ask you about how this package is delivering real results to improve the connectivity for regional and rural consumers.
Yeah, so it's got several aspects to it, and already we're starting to see the upgrade of battery life. Excuse me. My landline still works. It'll be someone selling me a gas connection from Melbourne, so deal with that. Sorry.
It's your telemarketers. But,
quite often the reason that the telephone connection goes out is because the electricity is impacted through the lines are burnt or something, and so having a longer battery backup, and so some of that battery backup had got back to only being a couple of hours, and so now we're looking at a minimum of 12 hours, and in some cases it will be better than that. The other one is because you can't really predict where the next area of fires will be, it's important that we've got mobile connections so that when we've had a major fire like we had last summer, people can connect firstly with loved ones to let them know that they're well or otherwise, and then, you know, make the initial conversations with their insurance companies or whatever. And so we've committed to funding mobile cells on wheels, the NBN trucks that have mobile hotspots, and the mobile exchanges on wheels, so that we can wheel those in, so that there is connectivity right away, and we don't really have to try and predict where the next fire is going to be. And the other part of that, we've funded direct satellite discs to about 2,000 command centres, evacuation centres, so that there are hotspots there where people can communicate. And then, you know, part of the black spot rollout now with 5A and beyond are looking at also bushfire prone areas for putting up, you know, new towers as well.
Yep. Well, thanks for that. My last question relates to the fact that we always seem to be chasing metro equivalent services for rural and regional consumers. And the reality that one of the arguments that comes back is that it's very costly to provide services to rural, regional and remote consumers. And so I was wondering what your thoughts are in relation to getting some kind of recurrent mechanism to ensure ongoing investment in regional areas. And one of the ideas in the past has been a communications fund that delivers some interest, that then that interest can be spent to reinvest in regional telecommunications. Do you have any thoughts about that and whether you support something like that?
Look, I've been around for a while now, and I wasn't. I came in after the Howard government. I came in the same year that the Rudd government came in, and so anyone that's been around for a while will remember the debate around the sale of Telstra and the concerns of regional people. And part of that, and from memory, I think Treasurer, I think it was $2.4 billion was set aside from the sale of Telstra for a regional fund.
Yeah.
I actually was sitting in Parliament in 2008 and I voted against it, where that fund got rolled into the stimulus for the global financial crisis. And so, sadly, you can't put money away in perpetuity because a government that has the numbers in the House can change the law. So that was a disappointment, and I know it was to a lot of country people, but it's ancient history now. But we are using other mechanisms, and so with the NBN, there's an amount, I think it's $7 a month from every metropolitan service that goes into funding the NBN in regional Australia. And so we are using those sort of mechanisms. But I also think, the essence of your question is we're not ever going to get to a point where we've fixed the problems of connectivity, because regional Australians are actually leading the way with innovation. And as soon as the technology goes in to service a need at a particular time, regional Australians innovate and invent and make things that use that connectivity. You know, in my electorate, we've got monitoring of irrigation systems. We've got agronomists using drones. We've got we've even got you're competing with the young person on a tractor with a GPS guided steering system watching Netflix while they're going up and down, farming their fields. And so there's always an enormous need. And so the essence of your question is, yes, there is always going to be need to be contributions from the government and the private sector to continually upgrade communications as we see fit. I know a lot of people, to me, bemoan the fact that we don't have the analog system and they wanted their bag phones back. But they made phone calls. They didn't scan the internet. They didn't send texts. They didn't do anything else. And so, the technology is always evolving, and we need to do that with it. And that takes funds. And so we are committed to making sure that we continue that. We've done that recently with the Regional Connectivity Program and the continuation of the Black Spot Program.
Yeah, and we often find that the industry needs more input from regional users to understand the demand, because we think they underestimate the demand when they say that some areas are not profit-making. So I think that understanding of the innovation that regional users are actually bringing to the table is actually a really good point.
It's interesting. I'm also still a farmer in a very small way, but yesterday I was processing cattle we'd bought, and we were scanning them with an electronic device to keep track of the, through the National Livestock Identification Service. Then there's that gets emailed back to the central database, and another copy to your agent and all those sort of things. And so there's nothing that in the farming sector that we're not using connectivity for. And then, with more and more people looking to move out of the cities. That's becoming more so. Last year was the first time, I think, in history that more people have migrated away from the capital cities to regional areas than the other way around. And, I've got my daughter and son-in-law last year moved from Sydney to Tamworth. They still got jobs in Sydney where they spend, a few days a week in Sydney and the rest of the time working on an NBN wireless connection on the outskirts of Tamworth with city-based jobs. And so there's a lot of people doing that as well as businesses that are actually setting up out here. So, that needs just going to grow and grow, and it's important that we're flexible enough to understand that the technology changes at a very rapid rate, and we don't lock ourselves into a technology that's going to quickly become dated. And that's why we are putting innovation as part of the requirements and into these programs and the alternative voice trials and the other things we're doing, so that we do know what's up to date and what's going to work into the future.
Is there anything else you'd like to add? And I think we've covered quite a lot of topics.
Yeah, no, I think it's been great. I'm always happy to talk about it. I'm not foolish enough to sit here in front of all your members and viewers and say, we've aced the problems with regional communication. It is an ongoing issue, but we've come a long, long way. My electorate's 400,000 square kilometres, and while I don't have coverage over all of it, I do over most of it, with a big aerial and a booster in my car. And I spend more time doing my job in the front of a car driving along than I do sitting in an office. And that's pretty common. And so, we've got a long way to go or further to go, but I think it's we are making headway, and I think it's pretty exciting times.
Minister, thank you very much for your time today.
Pleasure.